then just dive right in. Follow my lead. I found a girl, beautiful and sweet. I never knew you were the someone waiting for me. 'Cause we were just kids when we fell in love, not knowing what it was. I will not give you up this time. Darling, just kiss me slow. Your heart is all I own, and in your eyes you're holding mine. Baby, I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass. We're listening to our favorite song. When you said you looked a mess, I whispered underneath my breath, but you heard it. Darling, you look perfect tonight. Well, I found a woman stronger than anyone I know. She shares my dreams. Share her home. I found a love to carry more than just my secrets, to carry love, to carry children of our own.
Love was calling us. I had thought I'd ever love anyone else. In my weakness, I think about us. And I think about the day you left without speaking. I think about us. About the love we have for our children. I think about us. And babe, I think about the way we laugh without a reason. I think about us, girl. Somebody tell me why I feel like I'm dying. Lord, what's come over me? Ooh, baby, can't you see that I can't stop loving you? I can't stop loving you.
Whether I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest. How can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto me, or unto the Father, but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for another day. We thank you for life, health, and for strength. We pray now, God, that you will bless this program, this service, this homegoing celebration to be strength to this family. And we pray, God, that you will have your way in this place. It is in Jesus' name we pray, and we ask it all. Amen, amen, and amen. You all may be seated. We're here to celebrate the homegoing service of Marcus Richardson. At this time, we're going to have our scripture reading, the Old Testament, Reverend Bernice Johnson. The New Testament, Pastor Joey Diaz. Let us come in this order, please.
Our Old Testament stretch reading will be coming from Psalms 23. Begin reading at the very first verse. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word of God for the people of God.
I'd like to read scripture from 1 Corinthians 15. I had a chance to meet Wuba. I didn't know his name was Marcus until about 2 years after I met him. I had an opportunity to be his youth pastor here in Monroe at Lee Park many, 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 many years ago now. To know Wuba is to love Wuba. That smile, I'll never forget. Can you imagine how big that smile is now? I have a picture with me and Wuba when our church allowed me, I think I was 22 or 23, I don't know why, they allowed me to take about 15 students to Mexico on a mission trip. And my favorite picture is when Wuba and I snuck off in the morning. We got up early and we found a pedicab, and I rode him around the town. And he had the biggest smile on his face. That's the way I know Wuba. Lynn and family, we love you guys, and we're praying for y'all. Thank you for letting me be here and read this. And it's a reminder what I'm about to read, that when it's all said and done, and there's many arguments about how it will all be said and done, when Jesus will come back. Some people claim to know the time or stuff like that, but only God knows. I'm not an expert on to know when he'll come back or how he'll come back, except what the Bible says, but I do know he will come back and everything will be worked out. Because I'm telling you right now, what we face today, death, it doesn't make sense because it's not supposed to make sense. Because death was not in Eden. It was not meant to be part of it. That's why we hurt. But soon enough, y'all, this is what's going to happen. And Wuba knows it right now. He knows this. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Death is swallowed up in victory. And right now, for Wuba, Marcus, it is swallowed up. There's no more death. There's no more pain. There's no more sin. And that's where he is. He is not here. He is not here. He is with the Lord. My greatest memory that I had with him is when he surrendered his life to Jesus Christ and started a relationship with him, and I had the honor and privilege to baptize him there many years ago.
Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come now in the name of your precious Son, Jesus. We want to thank you for the life of Marcus. God, we want to thank you for allowing him to be a part of all of our lives in one way or another. I want to thank you for giving us the opportunity to meet him and to know him. God, you just lend him to us for a little while. Now he has done what all of us will have to do. We pray now for this family. Father, we pray for the wife. We pray for the mother. We pray for his father, the grandparents, mother-in-law and father-in-law, sister-in-law and brother-in-law, and all of those that knew him. Father, we thank you now because your word declared that the day of death is better than the day of birth. You said in your word that those of us that die in you, we don't really die, we just go to sleep. Sunday evening, Sunday night, Marcus just went to sleep. He left some loved ones back here. And God, we know you will take care of them. You're going to be their God. You're going to be their strength. You're going to be their courage. We pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will let them know that it is well. It is well. We pray that you will give them a strength that's not their own. Give them a peace that will surpass all understanding. We don't understand it now, but by and by, we shall understand it better. It's in Jesus' name we pray and we ask it all. Amen, amen, and amen. At this time, we will have a selection from Pastor Sylvia McClendon.
Praise God. I like to say I give honor to God, to Bishop, Pastor L.B., my other cousin, Pastor L.B., amen, to this beautiful family. I remember Marcus as a little boy. Amen. And as we was looking at the pictures, I thought about his grandfather. He looked like his grandfather, Mother Yvonne. Amen. And then as he got older, he started looking like his dad. Amen. I was trying to see Michelle in him, but he was so handsome. And you did the best you can. You did your job, and the people are here to show love, to say that you did an awesome job. So don't look back, amen, go forward to his wife, to the family. God is able. He will sustain you. And I just like to say this. Because the Lord is my shepherd, and I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadows grass, and he leads me beside the quiet stream. He restored my failing and he helps me to do what honors him the most. That's why I'm saved. That's what Mark said.
Hide me, y'all.
At this time, we will have the acknowledgement and the obituary read by Ms. Vera Huxley.
In loving memory, Marcus LaDante Richardson. Date of birth, August 28, 1990. Date of death, October 17, 2021. Age 31 years, 1 month, 19 days. Service here, Gordon Funeral Chapel, October 23rd, 2021. Our clergy, Bishop Walter Ellaby and Pastor Sandra Ellaby. Funeral arrangements by Gordon Funeral Service and Crematory here in Monroe, North Carolina, 1904 Lancaster Avenue. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. In memory of Marcus LaDante Richardson.
At this time, we're down for remarks. And on my paper, I have 2 minutes, please. So at this time, we're going to open for remarks. And the family has asked for you to do 2 minutes, please, or less.
All right, I'll try to keep this within 2 minutes. My name is Rouse. I'm Marcus was my freshman roommate when I got to UNC Pembroke, and we didn't think we was gonna like each other at first, because he was a LeBron fan, and I love Kobe Bryant, and he told me he saw my jersey hanging up, and he was like, oh man, I gotta make a change, bro, you gotta go. but we ended up liking each other, surprisingly enough, we ended up hanging out a lot, and we had a lot of things in common, like we love football, basketball, we love most sports, we hung out a lot, went a lot of trips to the cab together. And over the years, we grew closer, and he even introduced me to his Monroe crew. And boy, that is a crew. however, I will say that, they're a crew, and I love these guys. And I want y'all to know that Marcus lives in each one of you. One of the biggest things is that the reason why you're friends with him so long is because there's a characteristic, one or two, or a couple, or a few, that you guys share. So even though he is gone, he lives on through each and every one of us. You know, we've been friends 12 years, and I'm glad I've taken a lot of photos and a lot of videos over the years, because if I left it up to him or the rest of my crew that I know, we have 3 photos and 12 years of friendship. And We had three photos, and people wouldn't even believe. They would think that I'm making you guys up. Like, I'm making up a league. Nobody believed that we were friends, because there's no evidence. I don't know what's wrong with y'all. Y'all should take more pictures, all right? And I'm stressing that to everybody here. Like, if you have a group of people that you love and you cherish, and you're living in these moments, the memory fades over time. There's only so much your brain can capture. But if you have used technology and use it for that purpose to capture those moments, so when they are gone, you can reflect and you will always, and it like almost brings you back to that moment that you were with them. So do not be afraid to take your phone out, take a few photos, take a few videos, and then put it down, then go enjoy the rest of the day. But that's why I cherish that. That's why I'm so big on photos and video and like capturing these moments. A lot of people get kind of nervous about that, but they'll thank me. I always tell my mom, I say, you'll thank me years from now when we're looking back on this, all right? So I really stress that. And to end, I'll end on this, like, growing up with him or getting to know him, like, he introduced me to a lot of great people. One in particular is Lynn, right? And I never told you about the story, like, when he was telling me about you, and he was like, you know, I really met this really good, this really great woman, man. I said, well, who is she, you know? And he was like, her name is Lynn, and we have a lot in common. And I was like, I have a lot in common. You found somebody that likes to drink beer in the shower, too? I remember that story like it was literally yesterday. Like, I remember that, us having that conversation. I was like, man, she a good one, for real. She a real one. So I'm glad he introduced me to you. I'm glad that his spirit lives on through you. And I'm glad that, you know, we will continue to grow together. We all share this common bond. We all here for Marcus. And just don't take that for granted. Like, be grateful for the people that are here. Cherish them. Mm-hmm. Cherish them. Dude, if you have the time, please use it. Like, even if it's for a day, go see your mom. Even if it's for 15 minutes, call them. Just say, hey, just checking in. You know, as millennials, we're not really good about that. So, like, be better about that. Because one day, you know, we're all gonna be in this position. So I want you to understand how much that weighs, okay? All right, so.
Learn to love him. He's my boy. I and they ain't gonna know it shit. So his last meal was Saturday for me. He like, coffee, grilling, come on over. Well, sure. And me, like, not doing anything, it's all on you, son. But being a griller myself, I couldn't sit away. So I said, let me cut the onion and the tomatoes for you. He said, pop, in 5 minutes, I'm need some help. What do you need help for? You've been out there for a while, you don't need me. He said, Dad, you know I'm not too good on steaks. I know you like the word medium. Touched it. Said, son, you got it. Son, he took over, and that was the best steak that he cooked for me since he started grilling. And I want to say, everyone, I love all of you, the crew. I haven't met y'all long, but it seemed like I knew y'all forever. Because they embraced me, they pop, dad, and all of that. I love y'all. I will be around. I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, by the way, we didn't forget you rained down on our ceremony the other day, too. I need to go watch that Broncos game when y'all lost. But that was all right. That was tears that happened that day. We all knew it. We knew we wanted us to get in the bar or wherever we were to watch the Bronco game. So I want to say thank you for coming out. Enjoy yourselves. And I will see y'all tomorrow.
Hello, everyone. My name is Prixton Anuas. Formerly, everyone knows me here by PJ. As y'all may know, I don't get to come home as much. Actually, it's been about a good 5 years. But this man right here, before I left, he's always instilled nothing but encouragement in me. Said knowing me, I met him going to school with my fellas right here, my brothers. And I've been rapping in the group since, I say, 11th grade, about 10th grade. And he supported my music, would sit down with me, tell me about how far I could go. And I felt less as a man at a time in my life where I wasn't doing too good for myself, wasn't making good decisions for myself. And these guys and him held me down, created a foundation for me to continue striving and not giving up on myself. And the energy he gave me pushed me to make a decision and establish myself as a successful man, being in California, going to school for music production, and really saying that everything that I said, I'm doing it, you know. But last time I talked to him was in California. It had been years. I missed his wedding. I missed my brother's wedding. It's kind of hard for me to get home because it's pretty expensive to stay in California, as y'all may know. But the only thing he told me was, I know what you're doing. You're doing the right thing. It's best for you. I believe in you. I love you. And you know where I'm gonna be at when I come down. And I just want y'all to know that every gem that he's given to every single one of us, we gotta keep that shining, because I know he's encouraged every single person in this building. And that life that he's brought here, it'll never go away. So I want us to stay strong, continue this fellowship, and continue this foundation, talking to each other, staying connected to each other, not just for us, but for him. And I love all of y'all. I appreciate all of y'all. And I appreciate you for everything that you did for me. Thank y'all.
We actually got along with Reed to like the Atlanta Braves. And I said, well, you like football? He said, I'm a Broncos fan. I said, oh, you lost me right there. I said, well, you like college football? He said, I'm a Florida fan. I said, okay, this ain't gonna work out. I'm a Georgia fan. But man's not really a bad guy. It'd be me, him, and Jeff on the game late at night, laying in the background fussing. And he'd say, oh man, I got the game on the truck. You know, we'll crack our jokes. He's like, yeah, you won't play for nothing. He ain't getting on the game anymore. But the day that he said he wanted to get married and leading up to that whole event, I remember telling him, like, bro, you have a gift that you got to discover. You have a smile that can light up a room. You have an energy can't nobody else bring. He brought his pops with us to go to Top Golf. To me, when he brings family around, that's an important thing. The first time I met Lynn, I put a boating trip together. Everybody came, and he was like, you know, she don't know y'all, she did not talk to you. From the time she walked in, she laughed, she joked. And I told him, I said, it's a sister now, because you're like a brother. All of us played the game with Marcus, Javen, Coleman, everybody that was part of our little circle. We didn't get an opportunity to meet the Monroe crew. So I look at it as he brought you around, he was family. We will not get the opportunity to speak to him and Javen like we used to every single day, but we know day in, day out, they both watching over us. No matter what you're doing, they both in the same room with you. Physically, they may not be here. Spiritually, they're going to be with you regardless. Lynn, like I told you on Facebook, you got a bunch of brothers. As you can see, we love this man. Coleman sold us. I was in Jersey. I cried. I did everything I did when it was Jacob. But I realized, like, his mission here was done. God got something else for him. So, from all of us to his Monroe family, to his blood related family, we love y'all. We all family. Marcus, we don't know you as Book, we just know you as Marcus.
Yeah, that's cool.
We're going to miss you. I love you, man. Until you watch over.
My name is Jerome. I'm Javen's oldest, one of his oldest cousins, his little brother. I met Rouse and Marcus and Marcus. Anytime Javen came home, all he would talk about is Marcus, Rouse, and Marcus. I'm like, bro, who are you? I'm your brother, bro. Stop talking about you. I met Marcus, didn't like him right at first because Marcus always had something to say. No matter what he knew what he was talking about or not, he had something. After a while, I was like, he's not going to change. Might as well like him anyway. From, I think it was around January, as I said, Marcus always had something to say. It was one night, of course, we're the game. Y'all the Monroe crew. Y'all can call us the Concord Charlotte crew. Yeah. But we all family.
Yeah, yeah.
Marcus, it was me and him late. We was on the game late one night. Everybody else had got off. And we were both about to get off the game. And he was like, Jerome, I just want to tell you one thing. I said, what's that? He said, you got a good woman. Don't waste your time.
All right.
3 months later, I proposed to her. Marcus called me, and he was the happiest man walking. I think he was happier about it than I was. He was like, I told you not to waste your time, and he did. He was proud of me. And that was one of the best moments that I had with Marcus, just him being the good man that he was, telling me that he was proud of me. And the fact that after losing Javen, Marcus told me, he said, I can't fill Javen's shoes. Not even gonna try. But if you need anybody, I got you. And he was a man of his word.
no charge. Debts paid with love. 1 Corinthians 13, 11 through 13 says, when I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. But then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete. But then I will know everything complete, just as God now knows me complete. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Marcus, for 31 years I watched you grow from a sweet baby boy to a loving, kind-hearted young man. When you were here, I spent memorable time with you, no charge. It was grandma time. That's what we do, no charge. I had to shed tears sometimes, but those times I didn't dread, knowing that there were so many good times ahead, no charge. For advice that I gave, and all the good memories that I've saved, spoiling you with love and wiping your nose, only God knows, no charge. When Grandma added it all up, the cost of my love, real love, was no charge. Marcus, for the times that you called to see if I was okay, I needed anything, you gave no charge. For the times you made special trips to Mayfair to get my favorite seafood, even after marriage, you wouldn't need both to come, you gave no charge. For the times you would come by and take me shopping, and you never rushed me, you gave no charge.
That's right.
Oh, no matter when, the you ain't run my time, there was no charge. Even after marriage, the need joined in the grandma time, you gave no charge. All that you and the need did for me, you paid it all in full with love. Marcus loved and respected his family and all those he came in contact with, and he never made a charge.
Yeah.
It was all real love. Early Tuesday morning, I'm talking early Tuesday morning, your spirit kissed me on my right cheek and said, I love you, Grandma. I knew there was no charge, just real love. Always and forever, rest in peace. Grandma loves you.
Good afternoon.
I'm
Marcus's uncle. And I just stand to say that I really love that young man. I spoke with him Saturday night. Some of you may know that Marcus had put a post out and said, what do you do when it seems like God is not listening or don't hear you? Well, I didn't respond to the post. I reached out to talk to Marcus. And I said, Marcus, I said, I don't want to read into your post. I said, but I seen it. He said, I said, I don't know if it was for someone else or was it for you. And Marcus said, well, no, I was feeling a certain kind of way. And the reason why I'm sharing my conversation is to bring peace to people that say, well, he was going through such a. He said, I was feeling a certain type of way. And I looked over and Lynn was asleep. He said, and I didn't want to bother her. He said, I would never put my business out there. He said, but I just posted this. He said, but you know what, he said, I went to sleep. And I woke up the next morning, which is today, and he said, and I felt so much better. I said, well, Marcus, I said, I tell you what, I'm not going to throw a whole lot of scriptures on you or nothing like that, but I'm going to give you one to let you know that the Lord was listening to you. I said, Marcus, the scripture said that weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. I said, now you said that you got rest and overnight, and when you woke up that morning, you feel much better. I said, that's your answer, that the Lord hears you. He said, well, Uncle, he said, I'm going to go to a tailgate. And I said, you going to tailgate? He said, yes, and bear witness what his father-in-law said. He said, well, I just got through grilling out. And he said, man, he said, I really don't have to eat nothing, but I'm going to hang with my friends. I said, well, tell Lanika, I said, bake me a cake. And he said, okay. He said, better than that. He said, why don't we just plan a cookout? Because one thing about Marcus, he loves his family and friends. He said, let's plan a cookout. And what we'll do, you go get grandma. He said, and we'll just spend some family time. I had no idea that less than 24 hours later, he would be gone. I'm just telling y'all that this was one of the lovingest men that I ever come in contact with. He loved his friends. He loved his family. And God knows I ain't never heard him complain about nobody. Never. I just want y'all to know that Marcus loved us all. And this helped keep Lanique and the family in prayer.
Put an honor to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is truly the head of my life. I have known Marcus for 31 years. I met him after his mother and father. When my sister was pregnant with Marcus, we were told that he was going to be a little girl.
Yes.
So my grandmama started calling him Sunshine. Until we got a boy, and it was Marcus. And she still wanted to call him Sunshine. And I said, Granny, you can't call him Sunshine, he's a boy. So we fast forward, we kept asking Marcus, and not Marcus, Lee and Michelle, when can we keep Marcus? He kept saying, let me get a little older. Maybe 2 months in. 2 months in. Here Lee come with Marcus. Every weekend. We drop him off on Friday in the car seat on the kitchen table. And then pick him up till Sunday. Every weekend. We didn't have to ask to keep Marcus after that. We heard a knock at the door and we knew it was Lee dropping off Marcus. But we didn't complain about it. Because that was our time with Marcus. My mom would plait his hair down. And for some reason, she would sing him the Beverly Hillbillies. The Beverly Hillbillies is not a child's song. But for some reason, my mother would sing Marcus the Beverly Hillbillies song. So one day he said, Marcus couldn't pronounce Tabitha. So TC came about because my sister told Marcus to call me TC because he couldn't say Tabitha. So Marcus started calling me TC. So one day I started singing the Beverly Hillbillies. And he looked at me, he said, TC, you know the Beverly Hillbillies? And then there was another show called The Jetsons. Oh, yes. He would sing The Jetsons. But there's a part where it says, and Jane, his wife. And Marcus would say, Jane, who swang? And I said, who is Jane, who swang? But it never changed. My mother had a table full of whatnots.
Oh,
yes. Remember what Ann is? I hear you, Ann. Remember the whatnots?
Yes.
And we'll always tell Marcus, no, no, Marcus. No, 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 Marcus. And there was a little bell that she kept on her table. And Marcus would put the bell in his mouth, trying to touch the whatnots.
And I haven't owned that. And she said, Marcus, when I think his name is No No Jing Jing. You kept telling him no. You always have that bill in his mouth. So let's fast forward. Marcus played sports. I don't understand anything about football. Nothing. But we win because he played. Just because he asked, we win. I had three beautiful children that Lord blessed us with, and Marcus was there after the fact. He would leave and come back. He would leave and come back. Then he graduated from high school. A couple of months after that, he went to college. We were there. When we got married, Marcus was in our wedding. Marcus had on a boot, but the electric slide came on. And there he is out there kicking that big boot, doing the electric slide. But the young man that was up here earlier about the pictures and the videos, I have the pictures, I have the videos. So I have the memories in my heart.
That's right.
Because when all this is over and said and done, when I walk out that door, I'm not taking this casket with me. No. I'm not taking the flesh part that's in that casket with me. That's why I have the memories in my heart.
That's right.
No one can take those memories away from me. No. I'm going to miss those big hands holding my hand. I'm going to miss those big arms around me like if I could swallow me up.
That's right.
But I remember when I met Lenny. Marcus called and he said, Auntie, what are y'all doing for the 4th of July? I said, Marcus, we're not doing anything. Our pastor, they were having something at their house. I said, we're going there if you want to come. He said, okay. So he came, but I didn't know he was coming with Monique. So he comes up and there's Monique. And he introduced Monique to us. That told me something because I'm not saying Monique was his first girlfriend, but she was the first one he brought around me.
That's right.
And when he did that, that told me something. So Lenique off the bat started calling me Auntie, because Marcus called me Auntie. When he was younger, I was TC, then I went to Tab, and then I was Auntie. At one point in there, I became Sergeant Tab. And, you know, I had to have a little moment. So I remember one time, and I'm going to speed this up. I had to whoop Marcus. And I was there trying to whoop him with my hand. And then he told me it didn't hurt. And then let me go back a little bit. Marcus went to Morgan Elementary School. And he told me, he said, TC, he said, this little boy keep bothering me. I said, he said, he keep bothering me. I said, well, Marcus, keep bothering you, let me know. Now, I'm in my early 20s. We're talking early 20s and a 5-year-old.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know if it was his kindergarten graduation or whatever we went to, but we were there. And Marcus said, TC, there goes so-and-so. And I'm like, here I am, early 20s, and this is why I'm not going to jail. And I didn't say, he said, Auntie. And he told the little boy's name. And I remember it like it was yesterday. And he said, Auntie, there goes so-and-so, that's the boy that's been bothering me. I said, all right, Marcus. And we moved on from that conversation. But he told me that because I told him, if he keep bothering you, Marcus, you let me know.
Uh-huh.
Marcus and I would ride, he'd be in his car seat in the back, and there was one song that we listened to all the time. And I remember when I had talked to him, I said, Marcus, you remember that song? He said, yes, ma'am. He told me the name of it. I said, you still remember that? He said, when we get in the car, I put him in his car seat and we would ride. But those were memories from childhood, adult, teenage, adulthood, when he went to college, when he got married. Now Marcus always had a beautiful smile, but his wedding day, you out of the house, he twirls you around.
always treasured. When Marcus was here, Marcus knew that I loved him. Uh-huh. Does it hurt?
Yeah.
But I dare not count God foolish. Marcus knew that I loved him. And I know without a shadow of a doubt that he loved me. I missed the phone calls, the text messages, the pop-up visits, even this past Thanksgiving. The Nick and her family was at the beach. Marcus came. Cal was making his rain, but Mr. Rains and load up, and then he can tell why. But he wanted to go to be with Lenny at the beach. Now, we have German Shepherds. Marcus had a Leo was blessed. But because I love Marcus so much, I said, Marcus, we'll keep Leo. While you go to the beach, I said, honey, we're going to keep Leo. He's a home. Marcus said, how are you going to put on? I said, he said, don't you have to? I said, yeah, he said, well, auntie, Leo is a alpha, a dominant one, and we have Shadow, and he's a dominant. He said, that's not going to work. I said, Marcus, so you can go. He said, but because I love him so much, that I would have titled what we had so he could get to you. So I pray that everyone continue to pray for us, and we pray for you all. He talked about the twins. When I finally met the twin and Chase. Chase, you're Chase. I've always heard Chase's name, but I never met Chase. And then I started hearing Booba, and he never, I said, Marcus, what does Booba mean?
I've always wondered that. No one would ever tell me.
Yeah, and I said, Marcus, what does Booba mean? And he never would tell me what Booba means. So I just stopped saying, I just stopped asking, and you know, but he wouldn't tell me, so I figured it wasn't for me to know. But like I said, how I feel, Marcus knew. The love I have for Marcus, he knew it. I don't stay here because he won't hear nothing I'm saying. Because he's heard it. He heard it before he left here. But I have the memories. There's a lot of memories that I have and things we talked about that were always between him and I. So I miss the phone calls and the visits and the birthday parties he would come to, the cookouts, the holidays. Amen. I miss all of that. But I have it to look back on.
That's right.
So I thank the Lord for blessing me with Marcus.
Amen.
We pray for you while you continue to pray for us. Thank you.
We thank God for all of those kind remarks about a kind man. And we thank God for that. Lanique knows that she and her family, Michelle, Mother Calway, you all know you all in our prayers. Not just today, but you will continually, Miss Lee, be in our prayers. We went up to marry Lanique and Marcus. Let me say this, he was a young man. Young, sweet, respectful young man. Mr. Lee, you did a good job with him. But I never forget when we got, even before we got there. Now, Lanique did not call me to ask me to do the wedding. Marcus called and asked if we would come up. He took care of everything. Didn't have to worry about anything. I told him, I said, Marcus, I said, well, yeah, we'll probably come up a day earlier so we won't have to be coming. He said, that's fine, Pastor. He said, I'm going to get with Lanique and she's going to make arrangements and everything that we needed, they took care of that. I met the twins. I really just happened to bump into the twins. I thank God for him. Mother said it. He was a young man of love. He was young. A lot of time we don't understand young people, but we all been young at some time. Is that not right? Marcus was a young man, but he was a respectful young man. He was a sweet young man, and he just knew how to handle himself around people. And we thank God for that. Was the happiest day I know or seen in his life. We have pictures, Bishop, in our beautiful wedding, beautiful place. And I'll never forget, it was raining, it was sprinkling. He was worried about the knee. He said, Pastor, you think we ought to wait till it stopped raining because I don't want it to get wet? And I said, Marcus, whatever you decide to do, it's fine with us. But his whole concern was about this young lady. I met his dad. Man, when I looked at his dad, I was like, God, this Marcus. At first when we walked in, I saw his dad. We didn't see him. And I seen his dad, and I think he bumped into us, and Bishop said, hey, Marcus. He said, no, I'm not Marcus. I said, oh. But he just spit image of his father. Just wanted to share that. You made him happy, honey. For 2 years, you made him happy. God already knew. God knows the day of birth, and he knows the day of death. We just don't always know. And you made him happy. You folk, you young men, you loved him and he loved you all. And we just thank God for his life. Now, this time we're going to have Pastor Ellaby is going to come and he's going to give us a selection. After this selection, our very own bishop and overseer, Bishop Walter Ellaby, will come and give the last words concerning Marcus. Amen.
As I was contemplating what I was saying on a day like today, I thought about the story that Andre Crouch gave of the history of the hymn of the blood will never lose its power. 14 years of age, he was invited to a party, Memorial Day, and as he arrived, people were in the backyard and having a good time as people do at parties. And he was young and small and said, he was shy, didn't want to go out back, and hadn't too long been put on a piano by his father. And he said, he told the Lord, Lord, I love you. I really love you. And I want to write songs for you. He said, if you will allow me to write songs for you, I'll live for you forever. That was his words. He said, as he sat on the piano and started playing, so he began to see the images of Jesus carrying the cross up Calvary's hill. And he said to himself, oh, the blood. Oh, the blood. And he said, as he started singing, the people started leaving the party and started coming inside. I know that we sometimes have good times, what we consider to be good times on this life, in this life. But I'm a young man, 35, not much older than Marcus. But there is something better, and that is God. And in spite of all our errors, our issues, if we have that faith which Marcus had in Jesus, it never loses power, no matter what. So the song says, the blood that Jesus shed for me, way back on Calvary. The blood that gave me strength.
it will never lose his power. Paul, I like his hands. It reaches to the highest mountain. Whoa, it flows to the lowest valley. Oh, the blood that give me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain. Flows to the lowest valley. Whoa. Oh, the blood that gave Marcus strength may have been a short 31 years for us, but it went from day. Oh, and even on the final day, this is the good news. It will never lose. The alcoholic has to get another drink. I know I did, because it will run out. But the blood, it will never lose. When I was at the party and I was rolling up and smoking, I had to do it again to stay high. But the blood will never lose. The good thing about it is being washed once. It will never lose. Yeah. Never lose its power.
Yes, sir. It will never lose its power. It will never lose its power. Never lose its power. The blood will never, ever lose its power. Father, we thank you. We praise your name. We lift you up high. Your name be glorified. In this place, thank you for your son Jesus. Thank you for the life of Marcus Richardson. Hallelujah. Thank you for the comfort you providing for this family.
Thank you, Father.
And the comfort come from your word. Thank you, Lord. Save, heal, deliver, and set free. Use your servant in such a time as this. I yield to you. For you're the God of God, Lord, Lord, a great God, a mighty and a terrible, which regarding not person nor take reward. Deuteronomy 10 and 17. We thank you and praise your name. Thank you, Lord, for being with us. Your presence is with us. We're healthy, we're wealthy, we're wise. Your son Jesus Christ's blood is upon us. We are glorified. Your Holy Spirit within us, we're sanctified. And we thank you for your provision of angels that you've given us. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew's. Chapter 7. in verses 21 through 27. Matthew's. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall thereof. I want to talk to you today. This is what God gave me to give to us. While you have a chance, you may not have this chance anymore. While a period or interval of time, throughout the time that as long as, while during the time, while throughout the time, chance, opportunity, an appropriate or favorable time or occasion, a situation or a condition, favorable attainment of a goal, a good position, chance or prospect as for advancement or success. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. That's what Jesus said. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord. You know, it comes a time where we'll call on the Lord. There'll be a time where we don't pay God any attention, but it's going to come a time you're going to call on the Lord. You're going to need him. It's going to come a time where you don't think you need him, but you're going to need him. And for those that are calling on him but have not done what he told them to do, it's going to be a sad day. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. We know we go to school, we go to college, we work, we do things. But those that do what is required get the benefits. Marcus played football. You play football. A lot of us play sports. But you can't be successful if you don't make the practice. And when you make the practice, you got to give it your all. And the coach is watching the players so he know who to put in the game. And if you perform well in practice, most likely you'll get a chance in the game. And for those that feel like they're better than the one that's already on the field, you keep practicing because you're hoping that if they get hurt, you get to go in. You know, I played basketball, football, baseball, I played it all. But on the basketball team, I was real small. A little smaller than I am now, way smaller. And I thought I was better than the two guys that was out there playing point guard. But I figured something out how to get in the game because the coach would get highly mad at them guys. So when they would break, I would go sit beside the coach. Because when he got so mad, he would lose it and forget what he was doing and throw me out there on the court. Then when he threw me out there on the court, I did have 3 seconds to be in the game. But of course, one of them seconds, I had to go back to the score table to tell them I'm going in for number so-and-so. And then the coach is trying to figure out why I'm out there. And they said, you threw him out there, coach. And so I'm trying to get the guy to throw the ball to me so I give me a shot right quick. Because I know I ain't got much time to be out there. But I thought I was just as good or better than them guys that were making all them mistakes. But the next year, it made up for it because I got to start. But I had to keep doing what I needed to do, keep making the practice, continue to excel. But to not do anything and say I'm a player, and then to say, coach, put me in, coach gonna look at where you been. Same thing with a Christian or a person that said that of God. You're doing what you want to do, but when you get in trouble, Lord, Lord. Lord, Lord, help me, Lord. Lord, Lord. The Lord said, not everybody call my name is going to make it into heaven. You got to think about your life. You got to think about what you're doing. This is reality. I mean, people will tell you what you want to hear, but I'm going to tell you what God wants you to hear. You know what you do every day. It's either right or it's wrong. It's either God or it's the devil. It's either on heaven's level or the hell's level. Ain't no Hades, it's hell. It's a lot of right and wrong going on, but we got to address it, and you have to make a decision what you want to do. In school, right or wrong. If you do the wrong, you're in the principal's office. If you do right, you can't go to the principal's office. No need to go there. We have to address that when school is over. When the football, the basketball, all those seasons are over, we still are dealing with right and wrong. And what I'm trying to get to you as a clergyman, we're going to leave here one day. Marcus ain't the only one that done left. All of us going to leave here one day. And we're going to have to stand before God. And we can say, Lord, Lord, but the Lord going to look at what we did while we were here to determine if we should be with him forever or if he should say, depart from me. You can say, well, we just having a little fun. You know, you got to let your hair down, but you got to think about it. Right is right and wrong is wrong. And what you do has consequences. Am I telling you the truth?
Yes, sir.
So not everyone that said unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter to the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. When Jesus came to the earth, he said, what you see me do, my Father told me to do it. What you hear me say, my Father told me to say it. He set the perfect example for us to do as he has done. He said, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Now, this is moving from just secular. This is moving into the church realm. There's people who claim to be Christians, who go to church and are devout in going to church. Yeah, but they don't live nothing when they leave the church. They set a poor example for those that maybe want to live right, but they see your poor example and say, hey, do I want to be that? So you got another class of people, not the ones that's not making a decision, but those that said they made a decision, but you're living in limbo. I can't say I'm a clergy and do any kind of way. I can't say I love God, and then when I get out this robe, I go and live any kind of way, treat my wife any kind of way, treat my children any kind of way, treat my grandchildren any kind of way, live any kind of way. I've got to do what I do in the church outside the church. Because he's going to hold me accountable. It's got to be an example. Many will say, it's a whole lot of folks saying, but it's not a whole lot of folk doing.
All right.
In Lot day, it was a whole lot of folks saying, but Lot was the only one. Abraham said, if there be 50, will you spare the city? If there be 45, if there be 40, if there be 30. He got all the way down to 10. Lord said, if it be 10, I'll spare the city. It wasn't even 10 people in Sodom and Gomorrah that were trying to lead right. Even when we see the many people that say they love God, you'd be surprised the people that say they love God, but they don't really love God. We just love God for what's in his hands. But can you love God because of his hands? Can you love God just because he is God? Not only did he say that, they were prophesying my name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. We've done some works, but there are people who have gift and callings, but they're not of repentance. They haven't even repented yet. They just have a gift to do something. We have to put things in perspective so that someone will see who God is, because the bottom line is God wants to glorify himself on these vessels of clay. It's not about us, it's about him. It's what he wants in our lives. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. It's sad for him to have to say this, but he said, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings, coming to a conclusion, these people that hear these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken unto them to a wise man. Wow. A wise man. And this wise man built his house on a rock. When you hear what God says, you take it at value and you start building your house on a rock. In other words, you do something about it. You don't say, hey, I heard what the preacher said. That was good. That sounds good. I like the way he did that sermon. That was you understand that? But then you go and take your life and do what you want to do with it. But when you really listen to God, you take it at value and say, wait a minute, I got something out of that. I've got to do something with this. Wait a minute, there's some things in my life I don't like, and I can't do nothing about it. There's something wrong. So you come to the Lord, and the Lord can do something about it. You come to the Lord, and he can clean it up. You come to the Lord, he begin to put things in place and in perspective. That's a wise man. A wise man will say, look, I can't continue to do this. I can't continue to live like this. This is getting me nowhere. How many of y'all have felt like that? You know some things in your life, you know it wasn't right, and you had to say, hey, I got to do something with this. Ain't nothing funny about going to hell. Ain't nothing funny about living unsaved and dying and going to hell. Ain't funny about that. Ain't nothing funny about being drunk all night long, all day long, all weekend long. Ain't nothing funny about that. Your body is going down to a waste. You're wasting your talent, your ability, and most of all, you're wasting what God gave you because we all belong to God. You're a wise man when you listen to God. And he says, when the rain descends and the floods come and the winds blow and beat upon that house, it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. When you allow God to be your maker and ruler and you listen to what he has given to you and follow his words, then when the storms are raging, when it's all over, you'll still be standing. But he says this, everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man. Wise man, foolish man. You're going to have to make a decision today, my friends, which one you want to be. There's only one or the other, wise man, foolish man. This is what God did. God wanted to get everyone to see what he see. So how did he do it? About like these glasses and these eyes of mine and yours. God sent Moses and Jesus as the apple of his eye. He sent Moses to the Jews and the Hebrews. He sent Jesus to the Jews and the Gentiles. And Moses established the law, 39 books of the Old Testament. And he sent Jesus to establish grace, 27 books of the New Testament. And the 39 books of the Old Testament and the 27 books of the New Testament form the 66 books of the Bible called the Word, W-O-R-D. The W before the O-R is wisdom, and the D after the O-R is destruction. So if you are wise, wisdom. If you don't, you're a foolish man, destruction. That's what the word is, wisdom or destruction. That's why it's called word. Word. Wisdom or destruction. You either wise or you're foolish. It's not to slight anyone. You're either making wise decisions or you're making foolish ones. When I was in the world, I said, Lord, I ain't going to preach. I'm not going to do what you say. The Lord said, that's up to you. But when I ended up on drugs, alcohol, and illicit sex out there in the world, having a wreck every weekend, I could have died. I didn't even know how I got home one night. I said, Lord, please help. I was a church boy, singing on the choir. I said, Lord, help me get home. I was tore up from the floor up. And I said, Lord, please. I remember leaving the club, but I don't know how I got home. When I got home, I was in the yard. And I said, oh, I'm home. I said, thank you, Lord, for hearing my prayer. Little did I know God didn't hear my prayer, because my daddy was a deacon and my mama was a deaconess, and they was in the church. And that Sunday morning, we always had prayer. And my mama said, wait, can I pray this morning? And daddy, I cracked one eye open, and all the children was holding hands. And daddy said, go ahead, Mary. And Mary, my mama started praying. She said, Lord, I was up all night last night. And I thank you, Lord, you kept Walter, and he's around this table. Oh, man, I said, oh, God. Then the Holy Spirit said, I didn't hear your prayer, son. I heard your mama pray. Some of y'all don't know. God ain't hearing your prayer. He hears somebody else's prayer. But I wised up, and one day, thanks be to God, I didn't have to go to Black Mountain. Thanks be to God, I didn't have to go to a rehab. One day, I was on a job. I said, Lord, I don't know anything about preaching, but I'm addicted. I need you to set me free. And the Lord let something snap on the inside of me. 19 years old, got delivered, but I still didn't go preach right then. But thanks be to God, he delivered me. Because I want to be wise. Because if I'd have continued to live like that, I would not probably be here giving this sermon. But look at what God did. Because I made a wise decision, I'm here today at age 61, going on 62, because God wanted to use me to explore and to give some more wisdom to some other folk that used to be like I am. like I used to be, so that you can make a wise decision and you don't have to leave here like that. Marcus was a fine young man. Marcus was a nice young guy. Marcus was very respectful. Marcus, if you were doing something out the norm, Marcus said, "Hold, cool it down, man. Come on, man, calm down now." Marcus kept things together. He was standing out there in the rain, concerned about us at the wedding, concerned about us. How do y'all stay married 42 years, Bishop? And we were telling him, talking to him, while he was looking at his bride-to-be. But they only were married right at 2 years, but they gave each other their love. And we hate that this is here today. We're here today, but she can actually say, "He gave me all his love." She can actually say, "He was good to me." And Mark was standing here telling you she was good to him. But sometimes God allows something to happen so we can snap out of it. So that we can see that we need to make a wise decision. So you are going to be held accountable after this word today, because the word don't return void. So you can say, "Lord, I didn't know nothing about it." No, Lord said, "No, Walter Ellaby, the one you call bishop, he told you about it. He told you need to make a decision." See, because if you don't make a decision, you're unwise. For when the rain come and the floods come and the winds blow, the house will fall. And the devil will laugh. Because that's his goal, is to see that your house fall. But while you have a chance, you all say, "Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, I've been foolish. Lord, my mama tried to tell me, my daddy tried to tell me, my granny tried to tell me, the little boy on the street tried to tell me." You know, there are even some people that's in the world that'll tell you. When I went out in the world, the people that was already out there, they said, "What you doing out here, Walt?" I said, "Man, I'm out here. I'm going to have me some fun." He said, "Man, you don't even sound right. You a church boy. You don't even talk right. I tried to cuss. Said, you can't even cuss right. I had a cigarette. They said, you going to even smoke right. Because they know I didn't belong out there." But while I had a chance, I got it right. I heard Psalms and 90 stated that a man had 70 70. And by reason of strength, 80 years. That being the case, 70 years, 840 months. Huh? 3,640 weeks. 25,550 days. 613,200 hours. 36,792 minutes. 2,207,520,000 seconds. You have a time to make a decision if you were in that 70-year period. Some of us not even at that age, and still saying, "I got my life in my hands." But you don't know how long you're going to be here. 70 years, if you make it to that, is not much. When there were Methuselah living 969 years. 70 years, like a drop in the bucket. We all going to leave here. And the Bible said in the genealogy, and he died. And he died. And he died. We all going to leave here. We're going to stand before God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 10 said, "We shall all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and everything that we've done, the deeds that were done in our body, we shall be judged by those deeds, whether they be good or whether they be bad. And then he will determine whether we'll live with him. It will not be funny then if the Lord say, 'Depart from me.'" Why would I talk like I'm talking at this homegoing service? To give us wisdom that there is a real God, and he wants you to have fun, and he wants you to have blessings, but you got to do it his way. And it's your choice. He's not one that will force you to do anything, but he always put everything out there for us to follow. While you have a chance, for you may not have this chance anymore.
Amen. This time we're going to turn it into the funeral home director's hand. Amen. What a word.
Which one?
This one.